We're thankful to have John and Sonia in our midst. John's married too, as was pointed out in the prayer, their sister Sonia Cottle. They have three children, as was noted, Lauren, Jonathan, and Joshua, and one son. It says son-in-law. Can I say that you all sort of take him as son in love?
Yeah, I believe so.
I don't know how he takes you all, but that's the way that... I think he's still learning about that, isn't he, John? John graduated from the Memphis School of Preaching in 1989, Faulkner University in 91 with a B.A. in Bible, and Fried Hardeman University in 2000 with a Master's of Ministry degree. And he's still sound. And Houston Community College Police Academy in 2011. He hasn't shot his foot off yet by accident either. He preaches for the Dayton Church of Christ in Dayton. You've been there almost since y'all been here. About 8 years you've been here, isn't it? Something like that. And he's an officer with the Montgomery Independent School District Police Department. It's good to have John and the faithfulness of his whole family. Appreciate his love for the truth, what he contributes in all these areas, and being just a godly person wherever he is. We certainly wish him the best and look forward to hearing him preach on the fatal error on 1 Corinthians 12:13. Brother John, come preach to us.
It is indeed my privilege to be here with you. And the things that I'm able to do and accomplish today, I owe a great debt of gratitude to my wife. She is a great helpmeet and very much a strength to me and our family, my children also. But I don't give enough credit, I guess, to my wife at times. I do give her a hard time and like to joke with her, but she helps keep me straight. I guess like most wives do to their husbands. Amen. We're concerning our lesson today with 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 13 and looking at the fatal error surrounding this verse. This verse does not teach fatal error. However, we see so many people today that are using this verse, perverting God's word to teach a damnable heresy that will ultimately condemn men's souls. For by one Spirit, we're all baptized into one body. Whether we be Jews or Greeks or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, we're all made to drink of the same Spirit. The church at Corinth was plagued with problems and divisions within that congregation. Paul penned the 1 Corinthian letter as a result of their divisions, the contentions, their problems that was taking place. One such problem was the bickering over spiritual gifts. And in chapter 12, he deals primarily with this issue. Chapters 12, 13, and 14, he centers his teaching around the spiritual gifts, their problems, and the solution to their problems. The solution is found in chapter 13. And when one has the proper type of agape love that he or she should have, you're not going to have the division. And that's what Paul was trying to deal with in this particular book. And if you notice in chapter 12, he begins the chapter discussing the spiritual gifts given by God through the Holy Spirit, the laying on of the apostles' hands. And in verse 12, he wrote about the unity of the body, the church, where he says, "For as the body is one and hath many members, and all members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ." You notice he makes that change from the first part of that chapter, listing those various gifts coming by that self-same Spirit, to this one body which has many members, yet under the one rule and authority of the one Christ. He's reconciling the unity of the entire Christian system and then trying to deal again with their problems. Just as spiritual gifts were given by the same Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the church, the body of Christ, is controlled, led, and overseen by the one Lord, Jesus Christ, who is the head of the church. Today, however, 1 Corinthians chapter 12 is used to cause divisions by trying to teach things that are not contained in God's Word. We do not deny the fact that there were spiritual gifts in the first century, and there were miraculous gifts. But we do deny, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, we'll deal with a little later in this lesson, that these miraculous gifts continue till today. Because the Bible teaches they would cease, and they did cease in the first century. If we read chapter 13, we can read where the miraculous was to end, verses 8 through 10. Tongues, knowledge, would cease and would vanish. There will not be any need for the miraculous, because he said in verse 10, when that which is perfect is come, that which is in part shall be done away. Ralph so aptly pointed out in his lesson that that verse is not referring to Christ when he comes again in his second coming. It's referring to the Word of God, James 1:25, the perfect law of liberty into which we're to look to gain our knowledge and our understanding. It should be no surprise, however, that there are so many false views concerning the Holy Spirit with many passages in the New Testament, particularly with this passage in 1 Corinthians 12:13. Some are trying to teach Holy Spirit baptism from this passage, but we're going to see from this passage in context that it does not fit the teaching of Holy Spirit baptism. Before I get into the fatal error of this particular passage, let's look at the context. Look at what Paul is talking about and have a better understanding, then we can deal with the false views on it. In 1 Corinthians 12:13, we see, for by one Spirit, we're all baptized into one body. Again, as I mentioned in the beginning of this lesson, the introduction, the first 11 verses, Paul deals with the various kinds of gifts that came from that one Spirit. He transitioned into verse 12, talking about the physical body, comparing it to the spiritual body. You notice in verses 12 through about verse 25, he's dealing with the physical body compared to the spiritual. And in verse 13, he tells us about what we've been studying, what we've already read, for by one Spirit, we are all baptized into one body. Does this teach Holy Spirit baptism? Does it even imply Holy Spirit baptism? We're going to see where there are so many people today that try to pull Holy Spirit baptism from this passage, but contextually they cannot. Brother Bill Jackson, in his commentary on 1 Corinthians, wrote this concerning this passage. Now showing how we all make up the one body, he recalls that our entrance into the body by baptism. He states that we were all baptized thus by one Spirit. This is not a reference to the Holy Spirit baptism, but rather a baptism we all who have entered Christ, have had. By the one Spirit is by the instruction of the Spirit as set forth in the Scriptures. The Scriptures are a Spirit-written volume, 2 Peter 1:21. Paul states to this point is true for all, and again illustrates it by race and social status, Jews, Gentiles, bondmen, and freemen have all been made to drink into one Spirit, a figurative expression illustrating our partaking together in the things of God. I don't believe it could have been put any better than what Brother Jackson wrote in this particular passage. Because he's exactly right. How are we baptized by one Spirit in one body or into one body? Brother Johnny, in his lesson last night on John chapter 3 and verse 5, in discussing some of the erroneous views with that passage, I've seen the tie-in, and I'm going to look at that later in the lesson when we look at the fatal error part, the tie-in that some try to make from John 3, 5 to 1 Corinthians 12, 13. And unless we are born of water and of the Spirit, we shall not enter the kingdom of God. But some people need to look in their Bibles and understand how that operates and how that works. When we turn over to 1 Peter chapter 1, I believe it gives us a clear explanation of this passage. It's sad that so many people will pull one verse or one phrase out of a verse and base an entire doctrine or philosophy or theology on that particular section when there are other verses in the Bible that explains and answers that particular verse. Folks, for years we've dealt with denominational folks in dealing with the plan of salvation, where I've even had people say, you show me where it says have faith, repentance, confession, and baptism in one verse. It doesn't say it, but it does say that you can have faith and be saved. How do we answer them? Oh yeah, you're right, I'm sorry. It doesn't matter what these other verses say about it. There are times that because of the particular writer and what he was dealing with at that time, he emphasized a particular point. You might have to turn to another passage to find other things related to that point or a complete answer. Yet we have men today and people around the world that are trying to base entire doctrines on half a verse or one word or a phrase, and do not believe you can go to other phrases to answer that. Folks, they're sadly mistaken. They're perverting God's word. We are led, we are instructed, and we are taught by the Holy Spirit today. But we're taught and led and instructed by the Holy Spirit through His divine word that He's given to us through His inspired writers. 1 Peter 1:21. Peter did write in 1 Peter 1:20-21, knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old times by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Moved, being led along, borne along by the Spirit to write what they did and to speak what they did, to give us this inspired word today. This is how we're led by the Spirit. The Holy Spirit moved these writers to give us a holy Bible to guide us in the pathway of righteousness. The Spirit in no way directly leads and guides us in our words or actions apart from God's word, nor even in conjunction with God's word. But it's always through God's word. Nothing miraculous about it. The way we're led today, it was this holy word that was inspired that we follow today, that by which we are led by the Spirit. Not any particular miraculous leading, guiding, nudging, whispering in the ear, or visions in our dreams in our minds. Lipscomb wrote, "Some expositors think that being baptized in one Spirit refers to the baptism in the Holy Spirit. The example of the body led by one Spirit does not bear this interpretation, for it could not be said that they were all made to drink of one Spirit if they had all been baptized or overwhelmed by the Holy Spirit as the apostles had been on the day of Pentecost. Besides this, there is no evidence that all the disciples at Corinth had been baptized in the Holy Spirit. There is no evidence whatsoever that any of them have been. While some will argue that we receive Holy Spirit baptism, it must be pointed out that Spirit baptism was never even a command. It was a promise. It was a promise given to the apostles prior to Pentecost. In Acts chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which, saith he, ye have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence." Wait for the promise of the Father. It was a promise. It's not a command. However, the baptism of the Great Commission was a and is a command, not a promise. When Peter went to Cornelius and his household and preached the gospel to them, he commanded them to be baptized in water, in the name of the Lord, Acts chapter 10, verses 47 and 48. Kaufman wrote concerning Cornelius and his household, "The divine manifestation of the Holy Spirit falling on those Gentiles of Cornelius' household was not for the purpose of saving them in any sense, but for the purpose of convincing the Apostle Peter and his companions of the propriety of welcoming the Gentiles into the church of God upon the same condition as everyone else." And if you notice what Paul wrote in Ephesians 4 or 5, by the time he did write the book of Ephesians, how many baptisms did Paul say there were? One. Not two, not six, not seven. One baptism. That was it. What baptism would that be? Holy Spirit baptism? Water baptism? Which one do we choose? We'll deal with some of Mac's things just in a moment, but there are not two elements in that one baptism. It's one baptism. We'll talk about that as we continue on. As a matter of fact, let's get into it now. Looking at the fatal error, it's being taught in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13. We're going to look at various people who have made comments concerning this verse. I want to spend a little bit of time dealing with Mac and his crew. I say his crew because he does have somewhat of a following. Primarily want to deal with him and his son Waylon. Mac tries to tie Holy Spirit baptism with water baptism by teaching two elements in one baptism. But folks, in the Bible, these are two distinct baptisms, not two elements in one baptism. Amen. And for him to try to tie those two in together is in of itself a false doctrine, because that is not what the Bible taught. That's not what Jesus taught in his ministry. And for him to say what he's doing today, as Johnny said last night, is just almost blasphemous. The apostles were promised the baptism of the Spirit. But we're commanded the baptism of the Great Commission in water for the remission of our sins. Look at the Great Commission, Matthew 28, Mark 16, and Luke 24. Look at Cornelius, an example of him and his household. They were commanded to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Baptized in what? The Spirit or water? Well, Mac and Waylon both believe that's both, the Spirit and water. Mac wrote, "I claim to be a Christian, or claim that to be a Christian, one has to be immersed in both elements. And if water is an element, the thing to be baptized in John 3:5, there is no hermeneutical basis upon which to conclude that the Spirit is not equally an element as is the water." See 1 Corinthians 12:13 with John 7:37-39. This is his Biblical Notes Quarterly. Two elements in the one baptism from John 3, and he tries to tie that into 1 Corinthians 12, and I believe we've already dealt with that. If you look at 1 Peter chapter 1, it tells us we're born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God that liveth and abideth forever. Yes, you can tie these two together with that conjunction and in John 3 and verse 5. With the water and the Spirit, but what is a Spirit? It's not the Holy Spirit baptism. You can't tie that in where he says, see 1 Corinthians 12:13. It's through the teaching of the Spirit. Yet Mac, because of his convoluted ideas that has transpired over the last 25, 30 years or more, he's going into this Spirit baptism. I'm waiting to see how long it's going to be before he's performing miracles. He's gone further in the last few years than some have gone, so he's going to continually go further and further till he starts believing he can perform miracles. Rolf, he may be speaking in tongues, at least he thinks so, in the next few years. It's sad that we have brethren who have gone to this and who are so foolishly following these false doctrines. But let's look at Waylon. On their website, Waylon wrote an article entitled, "The Fog is Lifting." I think he should have entitled that, "The Fog is Thick as Pea Soup," when you see the quote that I'm about to give you. He said this, and this is a quote, "What happened to Cornelius is what happens to us today. He had to be, quote, born of water and the Spirit, end quote, in order to, quote, enter the kingdom of God," end quote, John 3:5. In his case, now notice him, born of water and Spirit, and he references John 3:5, putting them together, two elements in one baptism, but notice what he says about Cornelius. In his case, Cornelius' case, the Spirit baptism preceded the water baptism because Cornelius was already, quote, a devout man who feared God with all his household, end quote, Acts 10:2, living faithfully under the divine law he had. His right religion, notice how he justifies this false position. His right religion was being replaced by his successor, Christianity. With the gospel spreading the message of accountability to Christ, Cornelius needed to enter the kingdom to be saved. Jesus poured out the Spirit on his household, resulting in their being baptized in the Spirit. Miraculous tongue speaking followed as a sign to the Jewish witnesses that the Spirit had actually been given to the Gentiles exactly as it had been given to them. That sparked Peter's question, quote, "Can any man forbid water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have," end quote, Acts 10:47. Thus born of water and of the Spirit, Cornelius and company entered the kingdom. They entered it the same way the apostles entered, the same way we enter, the same way everyone enters. Now let that sink in just for a moment. Let's go back to Mac, and we're going to tie Mac and Waylon's contradictory statements in. Mac taught that baptism has two elements, water and the Spirit, that occur simultaneously. He's using John 3:5. You're born of water and of the Spirit. He tries to make those two elements one baptism, which I've read where he said it does happen at the same time, but by implication, even if he never said it, by implication, they would have to occur at the same exact time since he ties them in with John 3:5 in that water baptism he received the Spirit. However, Wayland turns around and says, no, wait a minute, Cornelius got it prior to the baptism. He's separating the two elements into two different baptisms now and trying to still call it two elements of one baptism when they occur at totally different times. That's not two elements of one baptism. It's two baptisms, a Holy Spirit baptism preceding a water baptism. And using their own logic, it would have the Holy Spirit coming into a sinner, sanctifying that sinner to some extent, at least it'd have to if the Holy Spirit's coming into him, prior to being saved by baptism in water for the remission of sins. Folks, that's damnable heresy. And it's going to cost those brethren a soul in hell, and I'm sad to say it, and I'm sad to see it. But they're no different than any Pentecostal preacher anywhere in this world. I don't know if Mac is watching this particular lectureship. It wouldn't surprise me because of the subject we're dealing with. He may blow and go in his next issue of his biblical quarterly. But folks, this is heresy. And we have to stand against this. Mac and Waylon need to get their stories together, quit contradicting each other. How can it be two elements occurring at a simultaneous time when now you have at least the Son, if not both of them, trying to get Cornelius with the Spirit baptism at a different time? He's already said it's different. But then he said at the end of this, notice how Wayland even contradicts himself from the beginning of that quote to the end of it. He said at the end of it, they entered the same way the apostles entered, the same way we enter, the same way everyone enters. So if we're devout enough, the Spirit enters us in Holy Spirit baptism, and then we're baptized in water? They're going to start teaching that now, or are they going to still try to hold on? Well, it's simultaneous. It occurs at the same time. You can't have it both ways, Mac or Waylon. You're going to have to determine, is the Spirit coming in you as a sinner prior to your baptism, or does it occur when you're baptized? Waylon said it occurs the same as the apostles, the same as us, and the same way everyone enters the kingdom. But he just said that was a different instance because it's Cornelius and his household. If they're filled with the Spirit as they believe they are, I don't know if they need to get the Spirit to help them understand it better or they need to correct the Spirit. Somebody's wrong. And I know it's not the Spirit, but I know the Spirit's not leading or filling them to believe this false doctrine. Anyway, what does the Spirit do when he fills us? That's what he wants to say, that he does nothing. However, Wayland doesn't want to open the door to modern day miracles because it goes on in this particular article and he tells us that it doesn't open the door to modern day miracles. Nothing is happening in the modern day sense of miracles. Well, if not, then why not? Because if you're going to use Cornelius and say we received the same thing Cornelius received, Cornelius spoke in tongues after the Holy Spirit filled him. So why are we not speaking in tongues today? If we're going to get the exact same thing the apostles got, the exact same thing that Cornelius got, what happened when the apostles were filled with the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2? They began to speak in tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. What happened when Cornelius and his household were filled with the Holy Spirit? They began to speak in tongues, and if we receive the same thing, then according to their own logic, we will have to start speaking in tongues. And yet they said, no, we don't have modern day miracles. Folks, they can't have the cake and eat it too. They need to come up with something that's going to be less contradictory and less damning to their soul. And the only thing they can come up with to do that is to give up this false doctrine and start believing the truth from God's word. But notice something else that Wayland said. Throughout history, most saints have lived and died without ever seeing, much less performing, a single miracle. Just as a book is not equivalent to his author, so the miracles are not the Spirit. Is he leaving the door open to at least maybe a few people having modern day miracles? Now he says we do not have them anymore, But then he said, throughout history. What history? Explain that, Waylon. Is he talking about history in the first century that most people did not perform or even see miracles? When he says throughout history, that could be from the beginning of the church in the first century to now. Explain yourself, Waylon. You're going to make a statement. Use precise language to help people understand, because you're leaving the door open for modern day miracles, whether they believe that or not. Well, let's go to some other liberals and the Pentecostals, some of the things that they teach. The false doctrine of modern day baptism of the Holy Spirit is nothing new. This era has been around for many years. It's grown and continues to grow in popularity among some of these charismatic groups. These worship services, so-called worship services, amount nothing more than just a better felt than told emotional service that hypes up the attendees. That sounds more like a rock concert or more like some political rally where people are hooping and hollering to make themselves feel good. I mentioned to Rolf after his lesson on occasion on Sunday mornings while driving over to Dayton, there's a radio station over in the Liberty County area. One of the members told me about it. I flip over to it sometime just to listen to it. Very seldom listen to it anymore, but at 9 o'clock, a Pentecostal preacher comes on. Sometimes it's comical to listen to some of the things they do. I heard him one day supposedly speaking in tongues, and he was rattling off some supposed heavenly tongue that nobody can understand. No one interpreted for him. And I was yelling in the radio, if you don't have an interpreter, keep your mouth shut. If you're not speaking in a real language, keep your mouth shut. Well, I quit listening to him a long time ago. And a few weeks ago, I decided to turn it on to just see what they were saying. And I noticed he'd speak a phrase. He had someone speaking in Spanish in another phrase. Now, if he could perform his miracles like he claims he can, and he's made that great bold statement numerous times on this program, why can't they just understand it in his own language, like happened in Acts chapter 2 with apostles? Or why can't he speak it in Spanish himself? Why does he have to have an interpreter up? If he can speak in tongues like he's claimed he could, why doesn't he speak the English and then turn around and speak the Spanish himself? Why does he have to have someone else do it? Because he's a fake and a fraud. But look at the other charismatic types group. It doesn't necessarily have to be the true old-fashioned Pentecostals like what this group is. Not too long ago, I was asked for our school system to provide security for one of our facilities. There's a charismatic group that rents one of our schools for their Sunday services. They had a special service on a Saturday, and they asked me, could you go cover that for us? They couldn't get anyone else covered. I said, sure. Well, I went and sat in the reception area while they had their little shindig go on. And they had it down in the cafeteria, and it was just down a hallway from me. It sounded like I was sitting in there with them with the instruments going. It sounded like a rock band. They were so loud, I think people down the street could hear them rattling the windows at the school. Well, out of curiosity, I decided toward the end of their service, I knew it was getting about time for them to wind down. I decided just to walk down and peek around the cafeteria, see what was going on. When I ran to the corner, they had glow sticks out. Some of them were on their knees, some of them were up standing up, and they were waving back and forth. They had a huge stage set up. Now, this is not a very large facility where they are, and as far as the cafeteria, is for elementary school, so it's a small cafeteria. About half of it was the stage for the band and for their performance. The other half was what few chairs they put out. They may have had about 100 people there. You ought to see the kind of things that were going on in there. I thought it was a rock concert. And you can turn on TV and see some of these rock concerts couldn't hold a light to what these folks were doing. And they were calling that worship. I just shook my head and walked back off, went back up to my reception area and sat down at my desk again and waited on them to finish. It was sad to watch what people call worship and think they're doing so great of things for God, when they're doing nothing more than worshiping in vain rather than spirit and in truth. Many of you remember a liberal from back years ago wrote a book in the 90s about the Holy Spirit, a man named Terry Rush. The Holy Spirit makes no earthly sense. Well, Terry Rush uses 1 Corinthians 12:13, and he said this: we're in tune with the one and only Spirit. The one that empowered Jesus and dwelt Peter empowers and indwells God's child today. The access is to the same Spirit. He not only believes in the indwelling, but he believes in the empowering and operation. He explained later in his book, when he wrote about being filled with the Spirit, when the Spirit's in us and in our heart, it helps us to face life, overcome our problems. Well, I guess that means, David, we'll never face any problems as long as we got the Spirit empowering us. I mean, that's the way Terry makes it sound. He probably doesn't believe that, but that's the way he makes it sound in his book. But then he talks about preaching, Spirit-filled, empowered preaching, pages 36 and 37. He said, consider our preachers. There is no substitute for the Spirit within the proclaimer. His notes may be orderly, his appearance impressive, and his voice may bellow like ocean waves. Yet his message may be like cardboard. Now, get a hold of that one for a moment. Think about it. He said, of course all preachers have their off days, but many of us ail from a profound lack of enthusiasm, an enthusiasm that is only realized when the Spirit of God is within us. Bible class teachers will find themselves ahead of in effectiveness if they concentrate more on believing they're filled with the Spirit and less in filling their libraries with the latest innovative materials. Forget your libraries, forget your books. Let the Spirit fill you, and he'll tell you what to do in your Bible class, and boy, you'll really be enthused. Sounds like he wants one of these old rock concert, hooping, hollering, rolling the aisles, worshiping Bible class assemblies. He said the church is on a threshold of unconquerable increase if we can only acknowledge that we are filled with the Holy Ghost, or Holy God in spirit form. Spirit-filled preachers. Well, if you're not preaching with enthusiasm, folks, you're preaching like cardboard. I've seen a lot of enthusiastic preachers this week. You were Spirit-filled, weren't you, with the Word of God, but not filled with the Spirit in the way that Rush and Pentecostals want to believe. When we fill our lives and our hearts with the Word of God and have it as a lamp on our feet and light on our path, as David wrote Psalm 119, then we can be energetic. But what does it mean to be energetic and enthusiastic? Does that mean we have to yell and shout and stomp and run around and parade ourselves to make a big show in a sermon? No, it doesn't. We proclaim God's word. We proclaim God's word. That's enthusiastic. Whether a person's shouting and stomping or standing up and simply lecturing. Which I know that's not what Terry likes and wants. But folks, when we follow the word of God, God's pleased with us, regardless of where Rush or any of his followers believe it or not or even care or not. Let's look at something that Brother Camp said. In his book, The Work of the Holy Spirit and Redemption, by the way, if you don't have that book, you need it. It's an excellent book. He said this about being filled with the Spirit, and I believe this will answer old Rush and any other Pentecostal, because he's nothing but a Pentecostal himself. Holiness people assume that every time the New Testament speaks of someone being filled with the Spirit, it means the baptism of the Spirit. And the scriptures show that without a doubt, this is not true. The Bible speaks of people being filled with the Spirit before the apostles received the baptism of the Spirit at Pentecost. Since there's no indication that anyone received what the Bible calls baptism of the Holy Spirit before Pentecost, but certain ones were filled with the Spirit before Pentecost, it should be clear that to be filled with the Spirit does not mean to receive Spirit baptism. Now, he's equating these two, and maybe that's a good lesson for Mac. But Brother Camp goes on and gives some examples from Luke chapter 1 of those who are filled with the Spirit. John in verse 15, Elizabeth, verse 41, and Zacharias in verse 67. He then says, here are three instances in one chapter where people were filled with the Spirit and not one of them received the baptism of the Spirit. It is a false assumption to insist that everyone that was spoken of as being filled with the Spirit had the baptism of the Spirit. Rush does go on to believe the same thing, receiving the baptism of the Spirit. But Camp further states that the phrase filled with the Spirit denotes inspiration or miraculous power. I've seen a lot of our devotion songs that kids sing. You have to be careful about some of them. Some of them are good songs, straight from the Scripture. But I've seen some of them that say that we're filled with the Spirit, trying to teach young people that we're being filled with the Spirit today. Folks, whether it's in a songbook, a devotion song, a camp song, or coming from the pulpit, it's error. Because what he says and what camp talks about here and aptly explains it, in the New Testament, when someone was filled with the Spirit, they were filled with inspiration or miraculous power. We don't have that today. We may be filled with the Spirit through the Word of God, but not in the sense that it was used in the New Testament. We can be filled with the Word of God that came from the Spirit. But we're not filled with any miraculous means of the Spirit. When one teaches that we're filled with the Spirit today, by implication, he has to teach and believe we have miraculous powers based on what was done in the first century from those who were filled with the Spirit. Well, as we close, there is no biblical basis to believe that 1 Corinthians 12, verse 13 had any reference to Holy Spirit baptism. For by one Spirit, by the teaching of the Spirit, because by words people are saved, we're all baptized into one body. Paul, in trying to correct their issues and their problems, to bring unity about in the body of Christ among the Corinthians, used these phrases and these verses to help. And sadly enough, today they're being used to divide and to hurt. Those who follow this fatal error are led about by every wind of doctrine and will result in the loss of their souls. But we must be vigilant in teaching the truth and in combating error, standing up for God's word, upholding it in our lives, not deviating from it, and understanding the truth of God's word on this subject. Thank you for your time.
Well, I appreciate John's spirit giving us back 4 minutes and 34 seconds. You just sit down and be quiet, Terry. Why is it that you have to speak up every time? It just causes turmoil over here in these two, and I'm having a hard enough time keeping them down. See? We heard a great lesson. I thoroughly enjoyed it. When you couple it with what we've already heard, we just had a pretty good encyclopedia on this. When I think of my associations, at one time they were quite close, and I know it's true of Terry also, and some others, especially Brother Dove and Clish, with the Deavers, and me in particular with Mag, I'm just amazed that some of the things have come out of him. I think I know why, but it's my speculation, so I'm not going to go into that. But here's what I heard last night, in which I'd read it too, for the quotes they made. Mac's position is that you must be immersed in water, for that's where remission of sins comes from. Of course, then, in his false view, while you're under the water, sins are being remitted because you are obeying what God said do for the forgiveness of sins, which is water baptism. Then you're plunged into, as it were, the person of the Spirit. And that is to regenerate you. Then, when you're raised to walk in newness of life, then you're indwelled. Now, according to his doctrine, and somebody correct me if I'm wrong, those three steps must take place in that order. They cannot break that order. So you must have remission of sins, that's in water baptism, before you can be regenerated, that's by direct work of the Spirit under the waters, you're baptized into the person of the Spirit. Then, and so there's a difference you see in the regeneration, in his viewpoint, and the indwelling, personal indwelling. So you can't have a personal indwelling till you have what he calls the regeneration. The regeneration is being baptized in the Spirit while you're under the water, and you must be under the water to obey God concerning when you get forgiveness of sins. You can't have regeneration before forgiveness of sins, and you can't have a personal indwelling before the regeneration, before the forgiveness of sins. But now when he came down to Cornelius, the whole order is reversed. But Mac makes a big to-do, and Mac is logical-minded. Mac makes a big to-do when it comes to saying one must precede the second must precede the third. There must be forgiveness of sins. There must be regeneration before there can be personal indwelling. Well, Wayland's got something messed up over here. And he believes that's a case of conversion. And he believes that's the way it was with the apostles, with Cornelius, with all those in that day and time, and with us, and with anybody else who comes to the kingdom. But Mac didn't teach that way. Now, mind you, the first thing that Mac went off on in the 90s, and he debated first, was that the Spirit is personally indwelling the child of God for the purpose of directly giving out wisdom that is beyond normal human wisdom, and to impart divine strength beyond your normal human strength to will yourself to abide by whatever commandment there is that God expects you to obey. And he specifically uses the idea, here is a person who is not married, he's being tempted to use a male, he's being tempted to commit fornication, and he just doesn't have the strength to render obedience to the prohibitions that God set out in his infallible word, which is the sword of the Spirit, mind you. It's the instrument the Spirit uses to convict and convert and to keep one faithful. But you don't have enough strength as a Christian to resist the temptation to commit fornication in and of your own human strength. So, because the Holy Spirit is personally indwelling you, he then, and that's the reason he's doing it, you see. That's, according to him, that's the reason the Holy Spirit's personally indwelling you. Then he imparts divine strength coupled with your human strength, which is resolved to obey God, but of itself is not capable. But with the divine strength, you can, and thus you can resist the temptation to commit fornication. Now, that's his doctrine. I don't think I misrepresented it. And you better, by the way, if you're going to deal with these fellows, I don't care whether it's Mac or somebody outside the church, anybody else, you better know their doctrine as well as they do. And please don't attribute to them something they don't believe. That just cuts your own throat. So try to know exactly what they believe. And sometimes that's difficult enough. But I wouldn't go into a debate with a pure Calvinist without understanding Calvinism any more than I would anybody else. It's just, you just better know your enemy. You remember what Patton said concerning Rommel? Because Rommel wrote a book concerning tank warfare. And Patton said, I've read your book. Now, to see how that works in spiritual matters, Brother Foy Wallace used to say in debate, oh, that my opponent hath written a book. And when I dealt with a debate down here many years ago, some of you were there, with Ross had written a lot of stuff. And it came back to haunt him during that debate because he was trying to say things directly opposite from what he wrote, and we did not let him get by with that. So when it comes to dealing with these fellows, be sure when you represent them correctly. I don't care how false it is, represent them correctly. And what I've defined to you here is the first departure Mac made back in the 90s when it came to personal indwelling, direct work, to impart direct divine wisdom, to give you divine strength. Now, that's the reason that if you fail under Mac's doctrine to keep a commandment, whose fault was it? Was it the Holy Spirit in you personally? Therefore, the purpose of giving you divine wisdom and strength, because you sinned. When a Christian sins, per Mac's false view of what the Spirit does personally indwelling you, to strengthen you, tell me who's to blame. Because he is given, according to Mac's doctrine, to keep you from doing that, because by your own human strength you can't abide by it. But with the strength from God through the Holy Spirit personally indwelling you, you can. Now, here's another thing he brought out. And that's Todd Deaver, his other son. I had both of them in school for 2 years. And when Todd got through at being in school over there, he didn't even know. He said so. He didn't even know the position he held on the indwelling of the Spirit. In fact, he was leaning against the personal indwelling. Well, that's all we knew at that time as far as the differences. And we got along and still do with those differences because they do not cause one to go into fatal error, necessarily do so. But Todd is the one who helped convince Mac that there is a baptism of the Holy Spirit the way Mac believes it and it's been described. But now, Todd has completely apostatized. He doesn't even believe the New Testament is a divine pattern anymore. He's gone the Rube of Shelley, Max Lucado route. He doesn't even believe mechanical instrumental music is sin. Now, let's see here for a moment. Did he have what Max says all people have when they're baptized in Christ from the remission of sins? Well, he'd have to say yes. Now, he convinced Mac that there is a baptism of the Holy Spirit when you're under the waters of baptism for the remission of sin. Well, who went wrong with Todd? Are you going to say bad water? Yeah, that's what it was. But who did? He can't dodge this. Mac does not need to be allowed to dodge these things. I greatly wonder what's going on with Mac right now, because I know Mac pretty well. I haven't heard from him, and I don't, maybe other people have, but I haven't heard from him the last couple of years. Anybody? Is Brother Dub in here? I haven't heard. There he is back there. But I haven't heard. I promise you, I'll stand corrected if I'm wrong. God told Mac this to his face. I promise you this. Something is about to come out as a new insight into this. In the 90s, I told him, Mac, every time you debate this, you say something that is so off the wall, it leads to another debate. I said, why is that? Well, you just ought to be wanting to pursue truth no matter where it leads you. Well, yes, I agree with that principle, but is that what he's doing? That's the sad part about it is, it seems to me, the further he goes, the more self-contradiction there is. Right. That's exactly what they teach.
He's got that view, and that was at that time who had the leading of the Holy Spirit directly, or whatever they're going to say about it. And that was against Brother Warren, who was involved in helping David. He's moderating and drawing charts. And I mean,
and those are the charts, by the way, some few years ago I ran in contending just to show that it spoke completely against Mac's position today.
So Billy Lewis had it right. Now,
let me tell you something that I don't know how much was known. I told something the other day about visiting out there at the Deavers when I was in Austin as to what they said about the personal indwelling insofar as having it debated, and Brother Deaver was opposed to it because of the bad it would do for the whole brotherhood. Mac thought it ought to be done. They both had said at different times that they agreed more with Ben Bogard in his description of the Holy Spirit. I don't know how many people know that, because that's been held up, and it is a great debate between Brother Hardiman and Bogard as to showing how the Spirit operates through the Word when it comes to directing, leading, and guiding. And I don't know whether people realize that. Do you all remember, some of you do, I know, when Brother Guy Woods debated Blakeney? Well, Blakeney. I was there at the Franklin debate, but Blakeney. What was interesting there is that the Deavers were very opposed to Brother Wood's position. Now, I recognize he held some views that some brethren wouldn't on the manner or mode of the indwelling. I understand that. But there's far more to that. Brother Deaver told me himself one time somebody had given them a computer, a whole system. He was a former professor at Harding and liked Brother Deaver's work, and he had never met him, and he just gave him a whole computer system. Here's exactly what Brother Deaver told me. There has to be a reason that God has given us this. We're trying to figure out what. I don't think most people understood how much was going on that always precedes the doctrine some years later coming out. It was already going on in their thinking. And as I say, I was pretty close to them, and I was raising some questions myself. But I didn't know enough. I didn't, you know, you don't get these things. Shakespeare says they will out on you. Well, it takes a while for some things to out on you. And I think this is what happens. And I think there's also this continual study from their perspective and development of these things. So that's one reason that we wanted to do this lectureship in dealing with some of these matters. Some things can be innocent insofar as we said non-fatal error. If they don't lead you to violate an obligatory matter concerning what must I do to be saved and what must I do to remain saved. But sometimes those same things, you can go off on such an extreme on them that they lead you into a violation of what God requires of you in order to become a Christian or to be faithful to God. And I don't know, I just don't know what to think about it other than what I've said.